everyone. Welcome to LexTalk, World Talk Show presented by ClickAway Creators. Today we have Mr. Soumitra Banerjee with us. He's associated with one of India's oldest law firm, Fox Mandel, and is currently based out of Bangalore. With over 12 years of experience, Soumitra is one of the youngest partners in his firm and oversees the expansion of the corporate commercial vertical of the firm in Bangalore, Mumbai, and Pune. Soumitra has been advising all types of financial institutions and other entities on a wide range of matters with a special focus on investment funds, IT, ITES sector, manufacturing, and automobile sectors and startups. He specializes in managing commercial transaction advisory, including legal due diligence, documentation, negotiation, and transaction closing support. Soumitra is a member of IPBA and has been a speaker at its conferences. He's a regular speaker at Startup Leadership Program in Bangalore and Pune too. Soumitra has been a key member responsible for the corporate and commercial practice being awarded as the winner by Indian Business Law Journal, where clients have particularly complimented his commercial wisdom. He's considered as a recommended lawyer in 2021 for corporate and commercial practice by Legal 500 and has been awarded as the Indian Rising Star by Asia Legal Business recently in February 2021. Hello, Soumitra. How are you?
Thank you, Bharti, for the introduction. I'm doing good. How about you?
I am good too. Thank you for asking. And it's a pleasure to have you here with us. We're really interested. After knowing this much about you, I'm looking forward to what else do you have in the kitty?
Firstly, thank you for having me here. More or less, you have covered everything a very nice way of putting it. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Soumitra. I'm glad that you liked the introduction. So starting with the main thing, of course, I've covered a lot of things, but I would really, or us as an audience, would really love to know more about your journey as a legal professional so far.
Well, when it comes to journey, which started a decade back, I must say one thing that I have been very lucky because in legal profession, you need to have a good mentor. And to begin with, after my law school, I had a very good mentorship, which helped me to understand the profession more precisely. Second thing is that I was always being blessed by a very good team. Because in corporate culture, the main thing is your teamwork, right? It's not an individual's work or it's not an individual effort. It's a team effort. Whenever there is a good synergy between the teams, what happens is that you deliver what is required to be delivered to the client. And in turn, the client becomes happy about it. So I would like to say that the journey so far has been very good, very promising. And right opportunities have come in on time, you know, where I have been given ample, scope to demonstrate my skills and develop it as and when required. So altogether, yes, I feel I'm blessed.
Thank you so much, Soumitra. That's very modest of you to say all these things. But at the same time, I have this question, which I really wanted to ask you, that COVID-19, it has left an impact on all the professionals, including lawyers. How has been your experience? And the second question to that would be that what are the challenges as a professional you faced during this pandemic and how did you, mitigate it the same?
That is a very, very broad question. And there are multiple questions within that question.
Sorry about that. That is why I say that to add on to that. But please, I can repeat the question. You can just answer the first one now.
I'll try to answer as precisely as possible. COVID-19 did have left an impact in every sector, in every professional's life. And I have been no exception to it. Things were a bit slow, things were turning out to be very, very challenging in the beginning phase. But what we quickly realized is that, you need to be prepared and gearing up yourself to face it. And like my legal fraternity, my what had prevailed is the fact that we have quickly moved on to the technology-based processes. So in fact, we have embarked the technology, shift, the drift to the technology much earlier than COVID, onset of COVID-19, which basically helped us, to mitigate the so-called the slack which came in because of the COVID situation very quickly. So first and foremost, the challenge which we faced was that transactions were taking more time because everything was stopped. Everything, the entire globe was under lockdown, and transactions which should have been completed in a 1 or 1.5 months timeline, a typical acquisition if you talk about, or a typical funding if you're talking about, the timelines got dragged to more than 3 months, 4 months. So, and things became more and more critical because we had to keep looking into things in more meticulously because documents were not available. So from a business point of view, yes, when you're working from home, collation of document always is a challenge, especially when you're doing a due diligence or something like that. Availability of document is a challenge. But since we migrated to the, digital platforms, we were able to, mitigate that risk quite well. I personally have missed the human touch to the work because we used to meet like this on the Zoom calls and digital platforms rather than a one-to-one meeting. So there's always a human touch missing in it. But the team, the way we work, very quickly we were in a position to adopt that work from home culture, which means that we utilized the maximum way possible the flexibility of timelines which were available with us. Clients were also quite flexible because so-called the office hours got extended. So to be very honest, things which used to happen in 8 hours, for that same thing, we got more than 12, 14 hours because we were not traveling. So challenge-wise, number one, the transformation from the mitigation side, yes, the from a document perspective or from a making things in our system and process, because of our robust internal systems, we were able to mitigate that. So we had to put in some extra efforts. Now, transaction timelines, which were getting dragged, we thought, how best we can do it is the only key was patience. So yes, we internally understood that patience is the key. So we slowly started guiding our clients step by step, rather than rushing into things. So that has helped. Third is team coordination, bringing in more discipline. So that's how we have somehow got into the new normal now, post COVID.
But again, the human touch is missing, according to you, and of course, that's really, really important. But now the times have changed and pandemic has taught us a lot. I'm sure the things are going to stay this way for a very, very long time.
That's true.
All right. Coming on to my next question, Mr. Soumitra, how do you look at the corporate finance and corporate commercial law in 2021? And just your point of view, and how do you think it is going to change 5 years down the line?
Well, if you look into both the verticals, which you said, corporate commercial and corporate finance, they are very vast because corporate commercial more or less includes everything. When we talk about a joint venture or a kind of a merger, everything is covered under that. Corporate finance, again, is like private equity, debt, everything is included. Now, if you see the recent trend, the way our government and the legislatures have been working on, there's a lot of changes happening in the law. So, which means that things are becoming more and more wider, open, and the whole focus of the current government has been that to promote doing business in India. So, for business setups to function properly in India, and for foreign companies to come more and more attract to evolve India as an FDI, choice country to attract more investments, law definitely is changing. So, when it comes to corporate commercial, or if you talk about corporate finance, I see the scope is getting expanded, the horizon is getting expanded every now and then because of the change of law. I'll give you one example. say gift city, when we talk about, you know, the kind of incentive which has been given in the budget currently for the FPI, the foreign portfolio investors, or the kind of ease of doing business, like, you know, when you talk about Make in India or Startup India, you know, the support from the government, I feel that both these verticals will pick up and there will be a lot of scope in future, which means because more and more investments will be happening to the companies, and India will emerge as a FDI favored nation. So corporate commercial and corporate finance both will have a great scope down the line in 5 years.
Thank you, Soumitra, for answering that question. Now, as a lawyer with the specialization in cross-border M&A and joint venture practice, what would be your key recommendations to a foreign company who's looking for an acquisition in India or maybe a joint venture?
Well, that's a very interesting question, Bharti, I must say that. Typically when any foreign company or foreign entity wants to do business in India, both the routes which you said, acquisition route or a joint venture route, is the most favored one. Now, from a business perspective, the opportunity is already located when they have decided to come. You know, the point is, like, first and foremost thing at times which I have seen missing is that a little bit on the cultural background has to be focused upon, because India culturally is a bit different. When you talk about, say, any other foreign nations, India has its own culture, right? So to understand the mindset from the Indian entrepreneur perspective is very, very critical. And second thing is that, so when you talk about a joint venture, means you're basically coming in as a partner, you know, and joining the Indian company as its, you know, venture partner and doing something collaboratively or collectively together. So that cultural fit is very important. Second thing is that from the legal perspective, what we recommend is that please do your due diligence thoroughly, the legal diligence thoroughly on your partner, just to be sure that, that you are getting into a situation where the Indian company is 100% compliant. There is no tax exposures. The registrations have been in place, your licenses, your approvals are in place. The governmental filings have been done on time, the corporate filings have done on time. The labors, you know, the employees, there is nothing due against them. So a thorough or a robust legal diligence is something which is highly recommended. Second thing is that when you are talking about a kind of an acquisition, you know, that means you're buying out somebody, planning that buyout or pre-acquisition or post-acquisition phase has to be structured in a very meticulous way, so that once when you have taken over the company, when you are going to be into its operation, how do you plan the existing management? Do you want them to continue? If yes, for how long? On what conditions? At times, we have seen that there are gaps in the expectations, which often lead to either, failing out of a deal, or the synergy or the acquisition has not been the way it should have been. You know, the project, the outcome of that acquisition has not been. So these things have to be looked into. That management, how are you planning them to hold on, or you don't want to hold on? Then what are your plans in India post-acquisition? Are you looking for an expansion model? That's the very fundamental. To do that, what are the steps necessary? So that is on pre and post acquisition side is what we generally I'll recommend. When it comes to joint ventures, yes, know your partner well with whom you're going to enter into the joint venture, and do a diligence and your documentation, which in which special focus should be that what are going to be the contributions of each of the joint venture parties. Now, what are they going to bring on the table? Let it be very, very clearly demarcated and pointed out. And then if there is an exit, if somebody wants to move out of that joint venture, what are the best ways of doing it? So structuring it and implementing it is something which I will definitely would like to recommend any foreign entity, that you focus upon that, be advised, and take the right decision, which is very, very critical.
Thank you, Soumitra, for throwing light on that. And I'm sure it will be a great help to all our viewers. Since you focus on startup companies and you have been closely associated with the startup sector for the past 10 years, What will be your recommendations for the startup companies as a lawyer, mainly as a lawyer?
Well, to my startup friends, to my startup entrepreneurs, I would just like to share that, you know, in my last 10 years, whenever I've got an opportunity to be present among them, either through it's your startup leadership program as a speaker, or maybe it's in GINSERV or with NASSCOM. What I have seen is that in the initial phases of business, they are generally bootstrapped, or their primary focus always remains as to how to do the business, how to grab clients, or how to go out in the market and create a presence. But what they often miss out is the fact that, you know, you need to keep your house in order, which is required, because the next stage when they look out for either a kind of, being bought over by a big MNC, or they're looking for some kind of investments happening into their company through a pre-series or a venture capital round. At that point of time, what comes out is that if you are not a compliant company, if your house is not in order, which means that you have not been able to, maintain your legal compliance in place, it often leads to some trouble, delays, right? So please maintain your house in order, which means that you ensure that you are 100% legally compliant. Say, for example, like the government has now come up with a concept as recognized startups, which means that if you have the tag of a startup, you get a lot of benefits. Now, this is an awareness. So if you're a startup with an innovation idea, you should go for it. You'll get all those benefits. And post that, once when you have that, it helps, say, even for fundraising, if you look into, there are certain instruments which otherwise is not available to a company, it gets available to a startup. So if you are looking for a systematic organic growth, you need to be compliant. Your documentation need to be in place. Say, for example, if you are a service provider or a service recipient, either case, as a startup, you need to have your documents, contracts in place, which means what? Yes, it is true. At times, you may not be in a negotiating position. You may not be at an upper hand, but definitely you should protect your interests so that tomorrow in future, there is no contingent liability on you, right? Which can have an effect for failure of a contract, say. So you need to be very sure what kind of documents you are getting into, signing into. Yes, you need to focus on your business. It's very, very critical. But at the same time, you need to be sure that you're protected in future. So your documentation, your compliance, your house needs to be in order. Few of the startups, common problem I'll just share with you. The management team or the initial employees who join, they feel that how should we structure some kind of a sweat equity model or a ESOP plan in place? Retention becomes a challenge because obviously you're not in a position to pay very high salaries, but you need to retain them. So you need to plan out your retention plan. At the same time, you need to be very, very robust in case if there is a situation where some of the employees are leaving, or you might have hired a consultant and you have a fear that your IP might be at risk. So again, what comes into your saving is the document which you have signed. So you need to keep your onboarding documents, your exit documents in place, which at times I have seen my startup friends miss it out. So please do ensure that you're 100% compliant, you keep your house in order, your compliance are in place, and you project yourself as a company which is bound by corporate governance. So that is very, very important for your growth. And I believe that will be a very key factor for any investors to invest in your company as well.
Thank you so much for sharing your experience and knowledge with us, Mr. Soumitra. And I'm sure this conversation has been enlightening for a lot of people, because whoever had any questions, because these are the questions which are kind of really important to throw light on. Usually people don't ask them. And I'm sure if a layman can, like me, can understand all these things, and then lawyers, the upcoming budding lawyers, who are thinking about a lot of things, you know, future prospects, it would be really helpful for them. So thank you so much for having this conversation, Mr. Banerjee, and we really look forward to having a chat with you again in the future on some topics in the international legal industry. Anything at the end you would like to say to our viewers?
All that I can say is that the new normal, which is now being expected post-COVID, is challenging as well as promising. So let us all stay together and let's come out of the situation, which we are sure that we will be. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Banerjee. And for our viewers, you have heard Mr. Banerjee. And if you really like this chat with him, please like and share this video. And also subscribe to ClickAway Creators YouTube channel to appreciate what we do. And you have more coming from industry legal leaders. This is Bharti for LexTalk signing off. Take care. Bye-bye.